In a chapel, you might expect to find biblical stories or moral tales. But one of the lovely things about this place is that it's absolutely bursting with plant imagery. Flowers, leaves, and here is a really good example. This string course that frames the windows has got, in amongst the leaves, a green man's face. The green man is a face with leaves traditionally coming out of its mouth and blending into a bed of foliage behind. And whilst they're not very common in buildings in Scotland, we have over 100 here at Rosslyn. There are many theories about the origins of green men. Some say they are old pagan symbols representing nature and rebirth. Others say they are Christian images that represented man's sinful origins in nature. It is quite incredible to think that the Rosslyn stonemasons created each of these carvings from rough blocks of shapeless sandstone. It took about 10,000 such stones to construct Rosslyn Chapel, and extracting them from the medieval quarries would have been no small feat. To find out how the stonemasons acquired their rocks, I'm paying a visit to Marcus Payne, director of the Hutton Stone Company. He runs one of the last active quarries in Scotland, just 30 miles from Rosslyn.
There is quite a variation in colour in here, from buff to a sort of bluey-grey.
So obviously you've got this modern machinery here, but is the process more or less the same, or is it really highly developed?
The process is virtually the same. Mm. The large excavator replaces many men and really is nothing more than a very large crowbar. The actual process of working several layers back at a time, mm-hmm. so you reveal the top bed of each stone,
so
you can find the natural faults, is exactly the same.
Today, the stone is split using a pneumatic drill. But in the 15th century, it all had to be done manually.
We're going to split a block by hand to show you how they would have done it.
Oh, that's really interesting.
Yeah, the only thing we won't do, they used to split them with wooden wedges, but they would soak them in water and leave them for days, and I don't think we've got time to do that.
No, well, fair enough.
So this is how it's been split out for many, many years. As he goes along the pins, he's listening to hear each pin tension up so that they all begin to ring at the same tension, which means the tension is even, so the split is controlled. You can hear them starting to... There you go.
He can hear when
you can start to see the split is starting to come along. But you can tell which ones are doing the work now.
And there's
just that ring, and also you can feel it in the handle of the hammer.
There it is.
So it's doing more work.
Fabulous piece of stone.
Yeah.
So exciting for you then when you find a piece that you consider is going to be a good piece of stone, is it? So you.
Yeah. I mean,
a really big special piece.
To be honest, we never tire of finding really fantastic pieces of stone. You know, sometimes we might find a piece of stone here 5 metres long, and that's just a fantastic thing for us. So we're still childish enough to get excited about that.
I can understand it actually when you see the process there. It would have taken dozens of men several years to produce enough stones for Rosslyn Chapel. Today, it would take a few men just a month. But getting the rock out of the ground is only the first step. The rocks then need to be cut into neatly shaped stones before they can be sent to the stonemasons for carving. As winter turns to spring, the conservation work at Rosslyn picks up pace, and I've got a chance to see some of the modern stonemason skills in practice. The emphasis at Rosslyn is on preserving the existing stone carvings, not replacing them. But one exception is a damaged tracery stone supporting one of the stained glass windows. Greg Civils is the mason responsible for carving its 300 kilogram replacement. It's great to see it coming along so well.
Yeah.
And you've made huge progress. How long have you been working on this already?
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
These particular areas here are going to have a kind of leafy carved finish.
Lovely, which you'll do.
Yeah, I'll do the whole thing.
Fantastic.
So this is going to take me a little while.
Yes. What do you estimate? You've done it 2 weeks already.
I'm thinking hopefully in another 3 weeks.
So you're obviously a real perfectionist, though.
Well,
you must.
Yeah.
Be. I mean, look at these. They're so beautifully done, rounded.
Well, this is it. I mean, the craftsmanship of the original is high standard, and you know, in those days they had a lot of time. And they had a lot of passion for what they were doing.
Yeah.
I think they probably had quite a lot of, you know, religious maybe aspects to their work, you know.
Yes, so they felt they were doing it for God or something.
Yeah, perhaps, yeah. The only difference is that I'm using tungsten to cut the stone.
Right.
In those days, it would have been just sharpened steel,
right,
you know.
You must get terribly achy hands with all that vibrating.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the conception, it's quite romantic to be able to be a stonemason carving all this stuff, but in reality, it is very, very hard work. You're often out in the open, you know, in the elements, it's cold, and yeah, I mean, my hands are quite sore, even though I've been doing this for 15 years.
Yes.
You know, at times you just get very cramped hands, and you get, you know,
slip and hit yourself.
Well, no, it's just wear, you know, the chisel resting on that part of your thumb, and you get a different size thumb.
Oh, really?
You can
tell a stonemason.
Yeah.
But worth it.
It is. It's very satisfying.
Good.
Very satisfying when you can create something and stand back and think, well, that's going to be there for I don't know how many years. It'll be long here when I'm gone.
Exactly.
And that's a nice feeling.
That is a great feeling, isn't
it?
When you look up at that east window, you'll be able to think, I did that.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, fantastic. During the original 15th century construction process, there would have been several specialist masons like Greg working at Rosslyn. But the sad fact is, we don't even know their names. The only clues to their identities are the strange so-called mason's marks on the stones. They've often been thought of as something mysterious or secretive, but in fact, they're really a bit like a painter's signature. They're just the personal marks cut by individual masons to identify the work they'd done, to make sure they got paid for it. The conservation team has noticed that a few of the masons' marks resemble those from a nearby ruined monastery. Melrose Abbey is only 30 miles from Rosslyn, and Sir William would certainly have come here. Dr. Richard Fawcett, the principal inspector of ancient monuments for historic Scotland, has agreed to show me round. During the Reformation, Protestant mobs destroyed many of the stone carvings, but scattered about are nearly 100 that survived.
It really must have been one of the most impressive churches ever built in Scotland. In fact, one of the most impressive churches ever built in Britain. What I find rather exciting about this part of the church is that you get a very good indication of the change of attitudes to architectural design that you're getting in the later Middle Ages in Scotland. In the very earliest part, you have a very English building, and you see that best of all in that very rectilinear tracery.
Yes.
It looks almost as if it was designed on a piece of graph paper. Mm. But then there's a great change in the window that you can see just there. You can probably see that that's designed in a much more flowing
way.
Yes,
it is, isn't it? So what do you think were the influences for the change there?
It is rather intriguing because it's a sort of design that when you first look at it, you might think that it's harking back to old and abandoned mm-hmm. English types of tracery design. But that sort of design was being taken up on the continent in the very late 14th century. And in fact, here at Melrose, we're particularly fortunate that we have an inscription over there which says that there was a French-born mason called John Morrow at work here. And I think it's pretty much certain that he was responsible for the change in the design of the window tracery.
How interesting. So that you feel there's a bit of a French influence on
this. I think it's actually built by a French mason.
Oh.
And the rather nice thing about John Morrow is that he was no shrinking violet when it came to making claims for what he'd done. And on the inscription there, he very carefully lists some of the other buildings that he'd worked on. So you can see, John Morrow sometime call it was I, and born in Paris certain lie, and had in keeping all mason work of St. Andrews, ye High Kirk of Glasgow, Melrose, and Pasley. And you can see then goes on to Nidisdale, which is probably Lincluden. So I think we have to be very, very grateful indeed to him.
Absolutely.
That he was prepared.
That's a wonderful record.
Yes. If only more medieval architects were quite so arrogant and have a much fuller record of what it was that they did. Mm. You can see that this was the original outside wall of the church that was started in 1385.
Oh, yes.
When John Morrow came along, he decided to add this row of chapels on the outside. This sort of row of chapels on one side of the nave is something you find in quite a lot of continental Cistercian houses. So I think
so
it's
it
John Morrow bringing the idea over. What's so exciting is that he must have been one of the main channels by which these French ideas were introduced into Scotland. And I think what we then see at Rosslyn some decades later is a mason who was trying to reflect these French ideas without quite understanding them, it has to be said. And I think what we find at Rosslyn is an attempt to produce a building with something of the cosmopolitan French veneer by somebody who only was aware of these things at second hand.
Oh, well, that's very interesting. So they sort of went for rather an overabundance of some of the French
Yes. You almost get the feeling in parts of Rosslyn that they didn't know when to stop.
There are a lot of similarities here with Rosslyn Chapel. At the top of the abbey, I even find a carved green man. Oh, look at that. There's one of your green men.
Yes, yes.
So it's really nice and to see some of these little details here.
Uh-huh.
This is very reminiscent of some of the carving we have at Rosslyn.
Absolutely, except that at Rosslyn you have an awful lot of it piled on.
We certainly do.
Carving piled on,
yes.
Carving.
And these great gargoyles here.
Yeah. But you can see the famous pig over there.
Where is he?
Over there.
Oh, yes, I see. Yes, we've heard enough. I've heard so much about him. He's the pig with the bagpipes.
Yes,
I'm fascinated by Richard's belief that a French stonemason was responsible for many of the carvings at Melrose Abbey. A French influence on the construction of Rosslyn Chapel is also certainly plausible, as the St. Clair family originated in Normandy. And that's where I'm heading next, to the birthplace of the St. Clairs. It was from here, just 30 miles to the northwest of Paris, in the town of Saint-Clair-sur-Epte, that Sir William's Norman ancestors took their surname. This unassuming stone tablet marks the beginnings of Normandy. Because, as it says, in 911, in